Okay, so there's one other turn shape we might want to consider for a racer. That's because of certain situations that can arise in a race course. If you imagine this is a couple of gates in a race course, race is going to start his turn right above that gate, and he's going to make a rapid direction change and then try and accelerate towards the next gate and then do the same sort of thing down here. So he's going to start his turn right away and begin to accelerate. But what happens if he gets late? If for some reason maybe he chatters out right here beside the gate, or I don't know, he comes in low and starts his turn late. Well, he's going to wind up down here. How's he going to get back up over to here and make that next gate? Well, the typical solution is that he's going to rock onto the tail of that board, because that's where his weight's going anyways. And he's going to want to try and make this hook maneuver that brings him back up and over and makes another rapid direction change right down in here. Okay, so his turn's gonna do something a little funky. Well, how do we do that with a snowboard? Well, we can tighten up the radius towards the tail again. So let me show you sort of what that might look like. Manufacturers using a combination of radiuses will start out in the tip with a tight radius. They'll go to a longer radius. And then near the tail, they'll tighten things back up. We take a continuous approach with this again and start out tight, get longer, longer, and then start to shorten back up in the tail. So we've got a continuously variable curve that does the same thing. You start out tight in the shovel, get longer near the waist of the board, and then tighten up in the tail. This approach will give the rider the ability to have a tight turn or make a rapid direction change, begin to accelerate towards the next gate, and if necessary, roll onto the tail of the board and make a direction change or a rapid direction change at the end of the turn and correct for any mistakes. Free carvers who like VSR also like this because it gives them the variability in their turn shape from the tip to most of the waist of the board, but then at the end of the turn, if they want, they can roll back onto the tail of the board, use that tighter radius to generate some energy, and launch themselves into the air or get that snap that they're used to before they hit the next turn. So one of the things we can do with VSR is vary the range of the side cut radiuses. If you look at, say, a 184 GS board, it's going to vary from 14 to 20 and back to 17. That gives us that hook. We've got a relatively large 6 meter spread in the 14 to 20 range. If we go to a free carve board where we don't really want that board to accelerate to the next turn, we want to be able to complete the turn effectively, we probably want to make a more circular turn. And the way we would do that is to give a smaller variation to the VSR. So we might make a 2 meter spread in order to generate a more circular sort of turn shape as opposed to one that is tight up top, straight down bottom. So we'll start at maybe 11 meters in the front and finish at 13 meters in the tail. And that will give us a roughly more circular shape to our turn. The other thing VSR does for a carver is it gives you the ability to vary your turn shape with less effort. With a circular side cut radius, really the only way you can vary your turn shape is to downweight the board or apply more pressure to it somehow in the middle of the turn. With a variable side cut radius, where we've got a tighter radius up front and a longer radius in the tail, our center of mass, or the position of our center of mass, can be used to alter our turn shape with relative ease. We're not talking about dramatic movements, we're only talking about small movements about like this. So let's say we're on a narrow course or on a narrow trail and we want nice tight turns. Well, we can keep our weight near the front of the board and make all our turns more off the front of the board and keep those turns tight. Or if our trail widens out, we can keep our weight more towards the back and keep those turns a little bit bigger. Or let's say somebody comes in front of us and we're trying to avoid an accident. Well, all we have to do is move our weight back forward over the front of the board and we can tighten things up. So a VSR gives the rider the ability to control his turn shape much, much more easily than a single radius side cut does. You can kind of compare it to driving a car, or maybe an old remote control car, where if you're familiar with the old non-proportional control remote control cars, where you click the control over to one side and it just makes one radius turn, which is kind of what circular side cut radiuses can feel like sometimes. They want to do the same thing over and over again. Whereas with a VSR, you've got more proportional control of your turn shape. You can tighten it up or lengthen it out with a significant amount of ease, or much, much more easily than you can with a single radius side cut. Hopefully you found this video informative. With any luck, it will help you improve your riding. At the very least, it should help you understand your equipment a little bit better. When you call to place your order, we'll have something to talk about that will enable us to fine-tune your board and make it fit your needs. Thanks for watching. So there's probably a number of engineers and physicists out there who have rolled their eyes at my use of the term centrifugal force. Centrifugal force is typically referred to as a fictitious force or a reaction force. In Newtonian physics, which is what we accept as the law in the world of physics and engineering, we tend to observe things from a stationary frame of reference. In other words, from standing here. But as a snowboarder, we're experiencing the world from a moving frame of reference. From the demonstrations I provided, we were observing our forces from a moving frame of reference as well. And in that case, centrifugal force is a valid force, although it is typically referred to as a reaction to the centripetal force, or the force generated as a result of centripetal acceleration, which in Newtonian physics would actually be the force that the ground is supplying or applying to the bottom of our snowboard. Either way, it's a reaction. Both of the forces work, and for this demonstration and explanation, centrifugal force is a term that is understood by not only the engineers and physicists who don't like the use of it, but it is widely understood by anybody else who may not be an expert in physics. So that's the reason I use that term.